Hachette Audio presents One Long Night, a global history of concentration camps. Written and read by Andrea Pitzer.
To the dead and the dreams of a lost century. A note on sources. This book contains details from archival documents, on-site reporting, written memoirs and interviews conducted to obtain eyewitness accounts from detainees and others present in the camps. My first research for it began in the spring of 2008. Between 2011 and 2016, I traveled to archives and current or former detention sites at Tule Lake, California, Oswiecim and Warsaw in Poland, Dachau, Hamburg and Berlin, Germany, St. Petersburg, Russia, Prague and Šumperk in the Czech Republic, Gurs and Paris in France, Geneva, Switzerland, Tallinn and Kluge in Estonia, Santiago, Chile, Buenos Aires, Argentina, Yangon and Sitwe in Myanmar, and the U.S. Naval Base at Guantánamo Bay. I spoke with historians, activists, soldiers and attorneys, as well as former and current guards and detention camp survivors. While eyewitness accounts have their fallibilities, so too do official records. Both are useful. Where political pressures have infringed on detainee testimony, I have pointed out those distortions or tried to avoid passages affected in this way. The most detailed criticisms of concentration camps have sometimes come from enemy nations. In these cases, the stories are sometimes true, but not always comprehensive. Some sources are both propaganda and legitimate accounts. I've tried to use this kind of material judiciously. It is tempting to see the prisoners' stories braided through this book as somehow representative. In many ways, they are not. Most crucially, these are by and large stories of those who survived. In addition, the prisoners mentioned here are, on the whole, more educated, more politically active, and more likely to have been tied into networks of people inclined to help them. They often got administrative jobs, medicine from friends, or special favors. While many concentration camps did hold intellectuals, political figures, writers, and business owners, the majority of those sent to camps across the century were poor, illiterate, or apolitical. They are the least likely people to have a chance to tell their stories, and perhaps also the least likely to end up having their stories told by someone else. The loss of their accounts necessarily makes any panoramic picture of the camps incomplete. In addition, detainees had their own prejudices, their own faults, and even in some cases, their own crimes, which is to say they are human beings. I have tried to present them as such. Never shall I forget that night, the first night in camp that turned my life into one long night seven times sealed. Elie Wiesel, Night. It can happen, and it can happen everywhere. Primo Levi. Introduction. Sailing to Guantánamo. 1. A double-decker ferry carries visitors to the windward side of Guantánamo Bay Naval Base and drops them off at the bottom of a hill just short of Camp Justice. A handful of current and former detention sites, with names like Camp Echo and Camp Delta, cluster near the southeastern corner of the base, tucked behind chain-link fences topped with loops of razor wire. Those facilities, still in use, hold a small number of detainees awaiting proceedings, as well as others who will never see their cases presented at Camp Justice. The ferry docks at a utilitarian parking lot on Fisherman's Point, but the lot's bare pavement fails to reflect its storied history. In 1898, the U.S. Marines landed here during the Spanish-American War, coming ashore the morning of June 10th, setting fire to a seaside village and capturing the Spanish blockhouse perched above it before lunchtime. The hill became a wartime camp, then a permanent base, and U.S. forces never left. A bronze plaque embedded in a cairn of white stones by the water's edge commemorates an even earlier invasion. On Christopher Columbus's second voyage to the West in 1494, he visited Fisherman's Point too, having already claimed Cuba for Spain. The plaque states that Columbus and his men were hunting for gold, but not finding likely prospects, they left the next day. For more than 400 years after Columbus's expedition, Cuba remained a Spanish colony. But in the 1890s, Spain created the world's first concentration camps on the island. The death toll unleashed by that decision eventually led to the loss of the colony, with U.S. Marines coming ashore on the same spit of land where Columbus had stood centuries before. Until a few years ago, I had no thought of traveling to Guantánamo. My interest lay in writing a history of concentration camps. 21st century detention at Guantánamo might have seemed disturbing, but it had not occurred to me to think of it as a concentration camp. The more time I spent researching mass arrests and detention, however, the more Guantánamo kept creeping back into view. I couldn't imagine writing about the place without going there. And so, in 2015, I made two visits. The first gave me a chance to observe pretrial hearings in the case of the five 9/11 defendants who make an appearance in the last chapter of this book. Not being obliged to file a story on deadline, as other journalists on the trip were expected to, I opted to fill in for the absent sketch artist and absorb as much as possible in a courtroom custom-built for prisoners in the War on Terror. Having arrived in the 15th year of an ongoing story, I wanted to catch up. My second trip took me to the detention camps, or at least the ones that I was permitted to see. In both cases, setting foot on Guantánamo was like entering another world. The thousands of personnel and dozens of buildings that made up the machinery of detention for what was then a little over 100 prisoners felt overwhelming. The issue that most troubled me, the legitimacy of holding untried suspects for more than a decade, was not the minute-to-minute concern of the soldiers and sailors who were busy doing their jobs. The big questions had been decided elsewhere. There the detainees sat, and there they would remain as long as those orders stood. Yet after September 11, 2001, the U.S. consecration of Guantánamo as an ideal site for extrajudicial detention had been greeted with the same international dismay elicited by Spain's inauguration of reconcentración, mass civilian detention, in 1896. In crucial ways, the 21st century American detention camps at Guantánamo are descendants of the 19th century Spanish camps. But there are many generations between them, each iteration carrying elements of the old while evolving into something new. The history of concentration camps circles from Cuba around the world and back, visiting six continents and nearly every country along the way. Camps have been in existence continuously somewhere on the globe for more than 100 years. Barracks and barbed wire remain their most familiar symbols, but a camp is defined more by its detainees than by any physical feature. A concentration camp exists wherever a government holds groups of civilians outside the normal legal process, sometimes to segregate people considered foreigners or outsiders, sometimes to punish. If prisons are meant for suspects convicted of crimes after a trial, a concentration camp holds those who, most often, had no real trial at all. A detainee is the most specific term for those held in this way, but for the purposes of this book, they can also be considered prisoners or captives. Sometimes, as at Guantánamo, the naming of categories of detainees is bound up with specific legal protections. Prisoner might imply the granting of rights due to prisoners of war under the Geneva Conventions, so camp staff tend to refer to them only as detainees. Concentration camps house civilians rather than combatants, though at many points from World War I to Guantánamo, camp administrators have not always made an effort to distinguish between the two. Detainees are typically held because of their racial, cultural, religious, or political identity, not because of any prosecutable offense, though some states have remedied this flaw by making legal existence next to impossible. Which is not to say that all detainees are innocent of criminal actions against the government in any given system. Rather, the innocent and the guilty alike may be swept up without distinction or recourse. Concentration camps are established by state policy, or less frequently, run by a provisional government during a conflict or civil war. They represent the exercise of state power against citizens, subjects, or others for whom the government holds some degree of responsibility. Unlike prisons, camps often detain prisoners without a scheduled date of release. Where a date exists, it has generally been set arbitrarily and is changed without warning. Detention in a handful of camp systems has been framed as protective, ostensibly guarding an unpopular group from public anger, and sometimes they really have offered protection. More commonly, detention is announced as preventative, to keep a suspect group from committing potential future crimes. Only rarely have governments publicly acknowledged the use of camps as a deliberate punishment, more often promoting them as part of a civilizing mission to uplift supposedly inferior cultures and races. If mass civilian detention without trial is the defining feature of a camp, then it becomes possible to look at a whole host of categories of camps, many of which have interrelated histories over time. In internment camps, people are detained for a fixed or indefinite period of time, usually in the wake of a crisis. Transit camps generally deport people to another camp or region. Labor camps require work from detainees, usually on behalf of the state. And detainees in extermination camps are completely cut off from sustenance or murdered outright. Political philosopher Hannah Arendt described concentration camps as divided into purgatory, Hades, and hell. Moving from the Netherlands of internment to labor camps of the Gulag and Nazi death factories. But nearly all concentration camps share one feature. They extract people from one area to house them somewhere else. It sounds like a simple concept, but both elements are distinct and important. Camps require the removal of a population from a society with all its accompanying rights, relationships, and connections to humanity. This exclusion is followed by an involuntary assignment to some lesser condition or place, generally detention with other undesirables under armed guard. Of these afterworlds, Arendt writes, all three types have one thing in common. The human masses sealed off in them are treated as if they no longer existed, as if what happened to them were no longer of interest to anybody, as if they were already dead and some evil spirit gone mad were amusing himself by stopping them for a while between life and death. The concentration camp experience rarely begins and ends inside barbed wire. It is part of a process, usually one that starts with arrest and interrogation, continues via a journey of minutes, days, or weeks to a camp, and persists in exile or continued threat of punishment after release. The worst moments of detention tend to define the entire experience. As resistance fighter and Auschwitz survivor Jean Améry wrote, whoever was tortured stays tortured. A typical concentration camp includes communal living among hundreds or thousands of people, though in some cases, particularly in the last decades of the 20th century, detainees have also been held in small groups in an attempt to keep them hidden. There are few hard lines in classification, as concentration camps can bleed into other categories of camps, giving them dual identities. At some sites, convicted prisoners ended up comprising a measurable percentage of the population and were brought in to supervise and police political detainees. At other times, convicts were sent to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.